an accurate lift on. Right, well, now then. Oh. Hard work?
Just a little bit, yeah. I think I should have run the London Marathon for training for this.
All that physical fitness training that you do, that should have come in handy there.
Oh, yeah, it's very hot as well. Makes it worse.
From strength to subtlety, this tests finesse. If you don't drive smoothly, the ball rolls out of the bowl. It seems a far cry from rallying, but a driver has to be in harmony with her car. If you don't treat the car considerately, it'll rebel. As the day wore on, a little light relief, a non-assessed activity, kart racing. A good job the judges aren't watching this one. At last, the ultimate test, and the moment the contestants have all been waiting for, a drive in a real rally car. Not only had they to drive a loose surface stage, sight unseen, but they had Vauxhall Works driver Dave Metcalf as observer alongside. Londoner John Baltrop gets away to a confident start on this three-minute stage, but David Hamilton was just 10 seconds behind. David Mountain from Yorkshire cut it by a further 5 seconds, the assistant bank manager scoring well for his assured drive.
Fantastic, I tell you, that was brilliant. It's everything I thought it would be and more. It really was enjoyable. I could love to do it again. I could do it again now. And, great car, great time. I loved every minute of it. I'd love to do it full time.
It's very difficult just jumping into a car you don't know, particularly the loose surface. I think that's the hardest thing to get to know. Certainly the second time around was much more competitive than the first time up the stage.
Driving with great verve, Will Brown collected the highest number of points from the judges for his drive, although he wasn't the quickest. Next on stage was a confident Carol Newby, one of three female finalists who was soon to taste that famous rallying experience when the car bites back.
Now, what was all that about?
I just thought I'd have a look at the trees a second time, perhaps, and how to get it well wrong. This man keeps yanking the handbrake. I don't know what was going on. Oh, dear.
I was reasonably happy. There's a few corners I messed up. Sort of trying to not really balancing the car properly before I went in, and of course the front wheel drive is very understeery. But it's been smashing. Best 40 seconds or whatever for a long time, that is.
And so, at the end of a dusty day at Donington, the big moment, the results. Roger Clark, the only Briton ever to win the Lombard RAC, was on hand to dish out the mementos to all finalists.
Now the winner, the garland, the champagne, but above all, the rally drive on the Lombard RAC Rally. The RAF technician from Henlow, Bedfordshire, Will Brown.
Congratulations, Will. What about that?
Thank you. Well, I'm just stunned, basically. So I've followed rally ever since I've been able to drive a car. It's like a dream come true, really. Just stunned, basically.
Do you think he has real potential as a rally driver?
Yeah, certainly has the potential. It's just a case of from now, if he's willing to put a little bit of work into it and learn from and proceed with it. Like I say, he's got the basic car control, but he needs now to start and learn how to use the car rather than fighting the car to drive it. Just use the car and progress from there.
Well, that's all from Top Gear for this week. Our congratulations to Will Brown for a very fine effort. It'll be good to see the RAF in at the Lombard RAC Rally this year. If you think you can bear to see all that again, our normal Friday repeat goes out on Thursday afternoons this week at 4:30 p.m. on BBC Two. Next week I'll be at the NEC in Birmingham reporting on the International Classic and Sports Car Show. And we should be looking into the whole question of the madness that seems to have overtaken classic car value. So see you then. Until then, drive safely. Goodbye.
Dustin Hoffman stars in Death of a Salesman on BBC Two. In Radio Times, Dustin tells why the character meant so much to him. Win a luxury holiday. Spot the films in the Radio Times Film 90 competition. It's the Eurovision Song Contest. Get the lowdown with Terry and meet Britain's entry, Emma Booth.
Now, just promise me one thing, Emma. You're not going to be put off by the fact that there's 500 million people watching.
No, no.
The encouraging word.
And as heartthrob Jason Donovan gives a royal performance, he gives Radio Times the secrets of his success. Radio Times gives you a better picture.
Over on BBC One after the 9 o'clock news, the first of a two-part political thriller based on Morris West's novel. Caroline Goodall and Martin Shaw star in Cassidy. Here on BBC Two, in 40 minutes, Brian Redhead chairs a discussion on the methods and ideas of industrial detective and doctor Sir John Harvey Jones. That's immediately after his last case as the troubleshooter.
The nostalgic lines of the Morgan motor car have changed little since the 30s, nor has the traditional way the car is crafted. Today, Morgan has become one of the great British names, in demand all over the world as the classic hand-built car. But its very popularity is now its biggest problem. The company is faced with a backlog of orders they can't meet and waiting lists which have stretched to over 10 years. They desperately want to make more cars, but how? For Morgan, the need to increase production has become urgent.
But you really did have...
Sir John Harvey Jones, ex-chairman of ICI, is one of Britain's best-known and respected industrialists. He's agreed to try and help the company, which has fascinated him since his childhood.
As a boy, I used to lust and yearn for the day when I could own a Morgan three-wheeler. They were a great thing to dream about.
My wife's first car was a three-wheeler.
So. Was it really?
Where did you come from?
Leicester.
How long did it take you?
what
you said off last
the
April?
Pretty way.
I don't think I've ever seen a product which people actually love as much as they love these cars. It's clear it's got the most tremendous appeal.
At the moment, we're delivering cars to people who ordered them in 1978. That's 11 years ago, and it will probably take us the next 2 years to work through the 78, 79 orders. So those are firm orders with deposits.
You're telling me some of them are dead.
Some of them are dead, right? Three or four that I happen to know about, having looked through the list. But 460 orders on our books, and last year we got 12 cars.
Well, on the basis of 12 cars and a list of 450 people... It's a 40-year waiting
on paper. It's 40 years. I mean,
I'm definitely too late.
We do not want this long delay of, well, we're having to quote 4 to 5 years at the moment, and. Frank, I think that's a shame because people want Morgans, you know, and in England, they're pretty patient, they will wait. But obviously we lose out on customers. I mean, I know when we show at the motor shows, people come up to stand, oh, how long does it take to get a Morgan, you know? Oh, 3 to 4 years. Oh, that's too long, and they just walk off. Nobody could kind of quickly increase the numbers of Morgan produced, or do, you know, double production overnight or something like that. You couldn't, because all the people we have here, virtually, they are all trained here.
Training a Morgan worker can take up to 4 years, because the company is still making cars in the same hand-built way it has since it began in 1909. It's still a small family company, employing 130 people and turning out just 9 cars a week. Peter Morgan is determined to preserve the tradition and the business his father built up. From those first three-wheeled cycle cars, the Morgan Runabout aimed to bring motoring within the reach of everyone. But by the 30s, three-wheeled cars were on their way out, so Morgan launched their four-wheeled sports car. It's this model that's been the basis of the Morgan style ever since.
We have been doing 10 cars in some shops once a month in some shops, particularly obviously the chassis department. But other departments.
Now it's up to Peter Morgan's son Charles to carry on the family tradition, as Peter Morgan is due to step down as managing director.
But what we haven't done.
Charles Morgan is determined to tackle the production problem and has been trying to increase output gradually. He wants the workforce to agree to make one extra car a week, a move from 9 to 10 cars a week.
In other words, I'm afraid. I don't want to, you know, name a particular department, but
that 10 car to a shop with 3 in is worth a lot more than what it is to a shop with 18, which we've got.
Well, it's not. It's not, actually. Not if you. I mean, not if we do this and we look at what people actually get. That's what. That's exactly what I'm saying. Actually, yeah, is that it does work up, but you can't say that until we do it.
Really, you know, it's our job to make the cars and your job to sort out the money side of it. So, you know, you're trying to get us to sort everything out.
No.
In that respect.
No, we're not sorting. No,
to work it out, see if it works.
We'll sort out the money, but then the only way.
Yeah, but you've been saying this for years about this 10th car. We never get any nearer to it.
Well, you haven't been making it, that's the problem.
That's what I just said, because, you know, we haven't had a figure on the, you know, on the board in black and white saying what we're going to get.
Well, no.
I think Sir John Harvey-Jones could teach me an enormous amount about managerial skills, which. I never learned at university. We are a very traditional company, even down to not having a computer. But I think there's a very strong argument to say that we could be just that bit bigger and as successful as we are now.
You know, probably with all of us here, we can just about get the 10 out.
Before I visited the factory, I spent some time going through the accounts. What at first sight looks absolutely great, an enormous demand for the product, really conceals, I think, a number of problems. They're just not making enough profit to reinvest to secure the long-term future of the company. The first thing that immediately strikes you is that the company isn't going anywhere very fast. The level of sales have been about the same for some time, the level of profits has been about the same. They've obviously made a lot of changes and improvements in the car itself, but they're all fairly modest, and they are plainly stuck at a plateau. And that, despite the fact there's a large demand for the car, so something's very wrong somewhere. But until I see the factory, I can't really judge whether it's a people problem, or an equipment problem, or a layout problem, or what it is.
I'm sure Sir John will be helpful to us, yes, I'm quite certain of that. I think even if he makes some very critical remarks, I hope we've been building the cars long enough, and I've been in the job a sufficient number of years, not to worry.
This must be it. Well, it's a bit different to Volkswagen, which was the last car factory I went to. Yes, this is it, all right. Look at the Morgan.
Do have a chair, Sir John.
Yes, sir, John.
come to help us out, haven't you?
Well, I don't know. I hope I can. I'm not too sure. You're a slightly different problem to the ones I'm usually accustomed to.
Well, I'm sure of that.
But one of the things that fascinates me is that you do have such a very long waiting list.
You know, I call them popularity peaks.
Yes.
Hopefully they kind of stay there. But, no, by and large, Morgan owners are prepared to wait. Not in every instance. I mean, in Italy, they want the car right away. There's no doubt about that.
Italians want everything right away, don't they?
Italians want right away. But, no, in this country, people are patient. But there is an interesting thing, is that what I find is there's quite a bit of speculation goes on with the Morgan, because it is possible when you buy it to sell it quickly, delivery mileage and what have you.
Well, that's one of the things that slightly worries me. It seems to me one of the ways of putting the waiting list down is to push the prices up.
Well, yes. It's traditionally, the Morgan has always been a cheap car. And father, you see, he started with a three-wheeler. And that was, I mean, it was £85.
But you see, it can't be a cheap car, though, because presumably in a car of this sort, the labour content is, what, nearly, what, 40% of the cost of the car? Or?
I would say between 30 and 40.
Yes, I worked out about a third. No, about a third.
Yeah, I think so.
That's a lot, and if that's a fixed cost for you, well, you've got the potential for putting much more money behind the business if you wanted to, but you'd need a higher profitability than you're turning at the moment.
That's right, that's right.
But I can't see what's stopping your profit going up except a touching diffidence and lack of greed on your part.
Well, I often jokingly say that, you know, if I had a yacht in the Mediterranean, if it didn't turn rough within 2 days, I'd get bored and would be rather back here.
Hello.
Ah!
Glad to see you.
Yes, good to see you. Great.
I had a great chat with Peter. I'm fascinated to try and see whether your perceptions are the same as his or whether you have different views and what you see the main problems and opportunities as.
I mean, obviously, one of my feelings is that, you know, one ought to make more cars to satisfy this waiting list. You know, obviously, if one makes the extra car, that's 40 cars a year, you know, those extra 40, 50 cars would look quite good on our...
Would the labour cost be the same?
Yes. I mean, that's one of the things that I've, you know, tried very hard to make sure is this time round.
Yes, it should be, but it may be very difficult to negotiate that.
Well, that's exactly what I'm in the process of doing. I mean, I quite agree with you, it is difficult. And you know, obviously a lot of these arguments do end up on pure money.
Well, I certainly don't feel from either Peter or Charles the sort of urgency that I would have expected, nor the readiness to grasp the opportunities, because this company's got the classic opportunity of increasing its prices. If they don't take it, they're not raising enough money to reinvest, and unless they do, they won't survive.
Where we are now is obviously the spare parts department.
Yes.
Within this department here we have both production parts and parts for older vehicles.
Well, this is the moment I've been waiting for. Mark Aston, the works manager, is going to take me round the factory.
We try to supply parts back to about 1950.
Golly.
And so, although it's a relatively small department, the parts are obviously spread throughout the factory.
How do you control stock levels, then?
Well, when they start running down, that we can see that they're running down, we reorder.
It's a sort of visual control system.
That's right, absolutely.
And then you have, some genius somewhere analysing the throughput and deciding what is the appropriate level to carry?
Well, that's right. When it gets low, it comes through to Mr. Talbot, and then he comes through to me, and then we reorder.
Okay, now, walk me through a car.
Actually, through the production.
I'd like to actually follow where if I were a car, where I'd go.
No problem at all.
What I need to find out is whether, without altering the basically hand-built nature of the car, there aren't ways in which they can produce more and also produce more cheaply.
On this side, crack the axle and gradually build up the car until the
Hello?
Axle we can have a long session.
How do you do? Glad to meet you.
Hello
there. That's you.
Bye-bye.
Hello. You're the foreman, huh?
Oh, I am, yes.
How long have you been working here?
30 years, 31 years.
Always on chassis?
Yes.
My God, you must know your chassis by now.
Yes.
Have you seen a lot of changes during that time?
No, not a great deal at all, no.
I'm already beginning to worry a bit about the lack of more than the most elementary jigs or handy equipment, which after all don't make a difference to the essential hand-built nature of the car.
Out of the door here?
Yeah.
We can walk on through there. We go through there.
Right, where are we heading now, Mark?
Into the woodshop.
Yeah. You are slightly swimming against the tide, aren't you? Not slightly, you're substantially swimming.
Well, we are, in fact, in the way we're actually building a traditional sports car.
Yeah.
In the old-fashioned style.
And what is the wood used mostly?
It's all ash wood, basically. And it will be planed and cut to an appropriate shape.
Their pride seems to be in manufacturing from the furthest back state that they can buy the basic raw material. I mean, I'm surprised they don't start with the tree, actually.
The layout of the factory is actually historic.
I'd assume.
This factory was started in 1919.
Yeah.
The layout's absolutely unbelievable. And no wonder they have to start by putting the wheels on, because the car chassis is pushed up and down this hill for every additional step to be carried out. That's all money, all time, and all wasted expense.
Cockpit area will be panelled.
Yeah.
Go to the far end of the shop and the wings and the cowl will be fitted. Into the centre for the bonnet to be fitted.
I accept the need to hand build the car. But they don't even like to use power tools. And everything is done in the most basic way. I cannot see that a Morgan owner is going to be fussed whether people use a hand file or an electrical abrasion or whether they use hand snips or power snips.
How long have you been working here?
25 years, the first to next one.
Bloody hell. Did you do your apprenticeship here? How long did it take to train up in sheet metal working now?
They've dropped it down to 4 years now. It was 5 when I did more. You get people coming from other industry into here and they struggle.
But I mean, this is going to be such a limiting factor on anything you want to do.
It is.
That something you'll have to give here.
Yeah. This is a shop that counts with regard to the actual finished art. Certain planned batches that we produce in certain periods of time.
But I mean, do you have a planning system or a planning office or a...
We don't have a planning office. It's, again, literally done individually, actually, in the shops concerned and related. The sales office really controls the flow of production. Each week they will issue a ticket saying that is the number of cars we're going to produce on such a day.
How do you do? Glad to meet you.
We're looking around at our production.
Marvelling, actually. I haven't seen some of the lays you got. I haven't seen since I was a bloody boy. Now, what's the reward system? How are the bonuses set up? Are they work measured or are they...
Largely work measured, yes. Basically, with a discussion between the foreman and, in some cases, the person concerned. And
but I mean, do you have a work study officer here with a stopwatch and that sort of thing?
No, we don't.
No.
It's all a case of, again...
Well, experience.
And we've got a good idea how long it takes to make a component, for instance. The foreman, obviously, has, in most cases, actually made the component, so you could say to him, well, look, how long is it?
Oh, no,
That's John. One Morgan Plus 8, if you'd like to try.
Thank you very much, Dean. Which model is this?
This is a Plus 8, with around a 3.5-litre V8 fuel injected in.
My gosh, I hope you... you may never see me again.
Thanks a lot. Enjoy your trip.
My God, this thing sure can go. it'd stop as well as it can move.
I'm really deeply concerned about this company.
It is run in a totally unbusinesslike way. There are so many ways in which their profitability could be improved, in which production could be improved, but all of them involve radical change. The present approach of just trying to sort of foothill their way through to one more car a week and then another car a week is absolutely hopeless. Every single person I've met is imbued with a real fear of change. So there's an enormous inbuilt wish to hang on to the way it's been. Now, I think the way it's been is almost automatically doomed because it will become just too expensive. They need to put more investment in. They need to be willing to change a number of ways. And I'm not by any means sure that they actually have the capability to do all of that.
I'm convinced this factory can make a lot more cars. Now I need to meet Derek Day, the sales director, to find out what the actual demand for the car is before I decide what we should be aiming for in terms of numbers.
Well, you're the guy I've always wanted to meet, the non-sales manager.
That's true, yes, yes.
If you could wave a magic wand, what do you think the sustainable demand is, and then why do you think that?
I think realistically, if we could aim for something in the region of anything between 450 and 500 as a realistic figure, taking into consideration the way the car is made, I don't think it would be right to mass produce it. I think it would lose its individuality.
No, but you're working the other way around. You're working on what you think you could produce. You're not working on what you think you could sell.
I think that would be it.
But that number is without any form of back-selling or advertising. The car's, for all practical purposes, sell themselves, don't they?
Sure, they do. I mean, in my job,
I mean, you're really a rationer of cars.
Well, yes, if you'd like to put it that way, yes.
What is the waiting list now? I mean, how long?
About 6 years on a home market, yes.
But, I mean, you talk almost as though you think that's about right.
Well, it's demand against production, and, you know...
Production is something you can do things about. And that is, I understand, one of the things that is being debated.
Yes, we're trying to increase production.
But the starting point is still really what the demand of for this car could be, and we really don't know.
No, there is no, that's absolutely true.
Now I want to meet Maurice Owen, the development engineer, because nobody else in this factory is thinking ahead. And you actually can't be a development engineer unless you're willing to think about change.
The way we make the car, I think, is wrong. I think we should build them in different units. Build the body separately, build the chassis separately, and put the engines in at the end.
Well, that would make logical sense
to me.
Oh, I think
so. Because,
but you see, there's
thousands of pounds all around the factory just lying there in cars for 12, 14 weeks.
Well, I couldn't agree more. I mean, it's one of the things that really worries me. For a car to spend 3 months in manufacture in this factory with all the attendant costs seems to me to be absolutely crazy.
No, I think so. I quite agree.
Now, if you look at it as a business manner, it's not a business.
It isn't. No.
Let's see you tomorrow, then, lads.
I should be most interested what you think. What you felt, you know, having gone round.
Well, there's good news and
a long
bad
time.
Good news and bad news, of course, as always in these things. First of all, I mean, a company that isn't progressing is actually regressing.
Absolutely.
Because the world is moving against you. And in your case, I think I can see the ways in which the world is going to move against you. Unless you can actually make the money when you have the demand there, you are not going to have the money to invest. And slowly but surely, your own manufacturing methods are going to catch up with you, because you will be rewarding you have to reward your people at the rate of inflation. And slowly but surely, the car will become more and more and more expensive relative to other products. So over a period of time, it won't happen quickly. Over a period of time, even though you've got this order position,
you'll find the thing erodes. I have never been anywhere where there is such total conservatism with the little c, there's such fear that changing anything, anywhere, is going to destroy the magic. So my diagnosis, quite honestly, is any change is going to be a hell of a battle. Therefore, you may as well go for more radical change, because you only get shot once.
Of course, tradesmen are, you mentioned conservatism. Yes, we all are conservative, and my workers are too. There's no doubt about it, because change comes very, very hard indeed, you know.
In your shoes, I want the capability of making, the capability of making another 300 cars a year, maybe 400 cars a year. And if you had that capability, then it would be extensible beyond that.
You know, the only thing here that I would say is that a lot of people who have been very, very experienced have attempted to make, you know, a sports car like ours and be successful even at selling the numbers we do, and have failed. Mm. With all the best information at their disposal. So there must be something that we're doing sort of right at the moment.
Oh, no, look,
and,
you are.
And I think I accept your criticism entirely of slow change. And obviously that at the moment is the policy of the company. But it is beginning to work.
He went against our ideas somewhat, insofar as he wasn't impressed with kind of going for one extra car a week. He thought, oh, it should be 300 and no more, and no difficulty with 1,000 cars. Between us, certainly, we're not without experience here of trying to make more cars or how we do it. And I think he is of interest. He's impressed with the firm going as long as it has been and still in existence. But, no, I think I would like to go round the floor here and ask for your queries.
Well, I did find him quite knowledgeable, actually, and I was surprised, really, you know, having just been here for a day, how informed he was about the makeup of the car. And, but equally, I think we should possibly, well, go for 10 cars and see how we go from there.
A move to, say, 800 cars a year is an enormous step. But nevertheless, when you think of our suppliers, you're still a small manufacturer making 800 cars or 400 cars, but you've doubled the problems, really, with going for 800, haven't you?
So the practicality of producing 300 vehicles as we do at the moment, in the space we've got, it's impossible, I would have said.
I've got a certain amount of sympathy with his feeling that, you know, the waiting list is pretty strong. Maybe what we ought to think about is starting from base and actually looking at the whole way, you know, the car progresses through the factory. And, you know, with the help of new machinery and perhaps even a little bit of new technology. Mm-hmm. But with that proviso that, you know, we don't want to change anything, really, because everybody loves the car as it is.
It must be interesting when Sir John does come back with his kind of final ideas or suggestions, and in the meantime we should probably still try and make more cars.
Well, we are trying to do it, but we've had a bloke the last 2 weeks been on holiday, which has made it a bit difficult, but we're hoping to do 10 this week, starting from now.
If we do 10 a week for quite some considerable time, will they still want the cars? See, Mr. Morgan said that, I presume his father told him that not to increase output because it'll ruin the market. This is what I understand. So, well, I mean, I've been here for 40 years, and he never said anything about doing 10 cars to me, only just recently, you know, like. He'd been perfectly happy with 9 cars a week.
I'm convinced this factory needs radical change if it is to survive. It needs looking at the way the car is built, de novo. And they have at the moment got a real opportunity. Everything's going for them and nothing stops them except themselves. The difficulty I'm in is that I've already seen how conservative and how frightened of change both Peter and Charles are. So I developed a strategy which is to suggest that they should undertake a study. After all, that doesn't actually expose them to any risk, except the risk of finding out what could be done. The study should force them to then realise the sheer scale of what they're missing and the opportunity that lies ahead for them.
And I would suggest to you that small changes is the way to do it at this stage, because I think to suddenly change the whole manufacturing process, but you keep on
temporising. You say at this stage, that implies that at some stage there's going to be a moment when you can't do this minuscule progression a bit at a time. I actually don't look on.
Well, I think
I don't look on the change of one extra car a week as being actually significant in what we're talking about.
Well,
I really don't.
I mean, that's 40 cars a year, and that's significant.
I don't think that's significant in terms of the scale, either of the opportunity or of the potential problem. You know, I'm not for a moment suggesting that you have to tear up what you've achieved. That would be crazy. But I do think you should look at some alternative scenarios, and it seems to me the sensible thing would be for you and Morris and probably somebody else who know absolutely what the most modern technology can do to sit down and look fundamentally at the way the car is made and whether you cannot actually produce the cars as a handmade car more economically than you are at the present moment, and I'm sure you can.
The way you put it, I think, is putting a lot of pressure on me, and I think that that's right. I think there should be a lot of pressure there, because I don't think one should sit there complacently when, you know, you've
There's
got people
you
waiting.
You've got the job.
Waiting, you know, for the car. So
we have got constrictions, as you mentioned rightly. We've got a financial constriction. But equally, that's just as vulnerable if we do nothing. If we stand still, I mean, it's never been, one has rather stood still, but it's never been my intention to stand still.
I really do believe that that perhaps a radical solution, you know, should be looked at. And I would like to do that.
I just want
to make sure that the right people are on our side, because I think that, you know, there's a lot of experts in the motor industry who could come up with a solution, but I'm not necessarily sure it would be better than what we've got at the moment.
I wasn't even remotely suggesting you should use somebody from the motor industry. I think it'd be an absolute disaster.
Mm.
That's better. Yeah. Let's leave that alone. We'll do it this corner, shall we?
He did say have a consultant or somebody like that. But with the greatest respect, Sir John, you have to sort things out yourself. Nobody will do it for you. No. What I'm glad he did agree with was not to change the manner in which the car was made. And I'm afraid if he had said we should do that, he's tended to indicate that certain changes might be needed, but I think he's on a pretty kind of sticky wicket on that one, because the way the car's constructed is one of its strongest selling points. There's no doubt about it.
I've been back a number of times to Morgan. I've introduced them to a first-class manufacturing consultant, but they've not even carried out the study. That worries the hell out of me. I think the workforce and I think the car are worth more than that. They even have obligations in a way to all the rest of us, because they are a part of Great Britain Inc. and they do export, and we need everybody who's got that possibility to do it. Now, just almost as a matter of duty, I feel, I've got to go back and have another go. Although I do not do so with great expectations.
Well, we've built quite a lot of extra, bodies and cars, in fact.
Well, how many have you got per week now? 12, 14?
No. No, that wasn't on the cards anyway. No, if you remember,
I was pulling your leg.
It was a very small increase we were going for.
You were after, we were trying to go from 9 to 10.
That's right.
And are you consistently doing 10 now?
Not consistently, no. I mean, that's not to say that we haven't got some plans, from, discussions which we were having in the summer, and which may be instigated in the near future. But no, I'm afraid there's been no cataclysmic, change as such here.
I wasn't really expecting a cataclysmic change, but what I was hoping, you'd be sort of looking at the thing fundamentally again and then introducing a range of fairly radical changes in the manufacturing approach. I would hasten to say that I would ever have dreamt of your departing from the concept of a handmade car.
Well, I agree with what your concept of making change in that way, but I think it must be made with the consultation of everybody on the workforce.
Oh, of course.
And because after one heck of a lot of discussion.
Mm. But you've still got an enormous waiting list. You have actually got an enormous waiting list. And you had got the ambition when I first met you both of increasing production with an attempt to get the waiting list down. And you have had some marginal success because you've gone up from 9 cars a week to 9.5. But what are your plans to meet the waiting list?
It's so often once had this situation where literally we've got all these orders, but they're not good. They're not good.
You would like to think that all your customers are magnificent people. But when one of them then sells his order on for £1,000, £2,000, which you see none of, you begin to wonder, well, was he a very nice customer for a Morgan, or was he just a speculator in Morgan car prices?
Well, yes,
and if so,
but you might also,
do we want those sort of people? Not really.
Come off it. You might also begin to wonder why you don't put your price up.
And lose what are, in fact, very keen, enthusiastic Morgan owners who'll keep us going for 100 years.
No, not at all, because the ones who are going to stay.
Only the rich, and the rich are very fickle, and they only like you.
They're not so good an owner, anything alike. The impecunious man is the best owner.
That is something that is worth thinking about from a marketing point of view, believe me, I'm sure it is. Because, that is why, so many car manufacturers haven't survived, and we have.
I have pleasure in presenting you this magnum of champagne on the occasion of your birthday. Many happy returns and congratulations.
Derek and all present.
Yes, the 3rd of November was a very special day for two major reasons. Firstly, I got to the great age of 70, and secondly, it was my retirement. But I'm glad to say that they took me back on the Monday. I retired on the Friday and I was reinstated on the Monday.
And the champagne will be greatly appreciated. Thank you.
I think Sir John was very hard on us. I think he looked at us from a financial point of view too strongly, and he didn't take into account quite enough the desperate desire we've got for keeping going for another 100 years.
Well, they'll go on being very happy for a while. If nothing changes, I'm sure that everybody here will go on being very happy for a while. They will remember my visit, I hope, with wry humour. But if they really do nothing, and believe me, I pray they will make some changes, in my view, this car will disappear. I don't know how long it'll be.
but over a period of time, this will all disappear. Nearly 3 years since I last looked at 6 British companies and tried to give them some advice and help. At that time, we were full of confidence and everything seemed to be going well. None of us really envisaged the tough going it's been. Although a number of companies have fought their way through, a hell of a lot have been overwhelmed and we've got more than another million unemployed. And all of this has happened at a time when, for the sake of every one of us, we need more British companies to succeed in a world competitive sense. Before I set off to meet some more British companies, hoping to do whatever I can to help them, I'd like to revisit the old ones and see how they've fared. And it isn't just the businesses I want to see. I want to see the people. A lot of them have become friends, and people make the difference to businesses. So I want to find out what's happened to them as well.
Yes, that's it, all right, Arthur. This is the new bit of the factory here. And that's the mill itself.
I well remember visiting Triang, the first of the companies I was to go to in 1987. When I was a boy, Triang was the biggest and best toy company in the world. It fell on hard times and changed hands more than once. Even so, it was a real shock to see it in an old-fashioned mill in Manchester.
Well, this is a controlled chaos or uncontrolled chaos, isn't it?
How the hell
is it? Controlled chaos. Very controlled.
When I got on the factory floor, I was shocked not only by the clapped-out machinery, but also by the general feeling of muddle and disorganisation everywhere. They wanted to pour money into this, but they thought it would actually be wasted, and I didn't look forward to telling Sidney Orchard, the chairman, about that.
You have ambitions to be much bigger, and I would like to see Triang much bigger. But if you're going to do that, Sidney, then the management and the management style are going to have to move up.
Sir John.
Okay, as far as you're concerned...
We are good. Well, what we do, we are good. We stayed in business. We are making respectable profits now.
Sidney...
So we can't be bad.
Nobody's telling you you're bad. What I'm talking about is the future of the business. I do not believe that Triang can survive indefinitely on the factory as it is at the present moment.
That looks depressingly familiar. And we're just around here, aren't we? Yeah. What's it?
This is Triang.
Is this the bloody factory? It can't be. What a horrible shot. Says something, doesn't it, when just a ruddy raised site like this is worth more than the factory.
suppose this will just become more housing. But God knows whether people will work or what they live on.
I mean, I know that the toys weren't all that great, and but it just makes you boil with indignation, doesn't it?
Really does.
In the event, things had already gone too far when I first visited Triang, and they were sold on, this time, to a French company. So now the toys are made in France, and that's just another step back in the endless war of attrition on the British toy industry. Despite his dunkings, Sidney, the great survivor, still seems to carry on. So it'll be fascinating to find out how he's doing now.
Anyway, I hope you're not going to have a go at me today, because
I've never had a go at me in my life. I've never laid a glove on.
I have to point out to you that I'm now, this year, an OAP. Oh, so you have to treat me very gently.
Well, nobody's ever treated me gently as an OAP.
Yes, yeah, it's lovely to see you.
Well, I must say, I was very depressed when I saw the factory, Sidney. But what's all this? I mean, toys again.
Well, this is Sunny Smile. It's nursery toys and preschool. So yeah. I'm still in the toy business.
I always thought you would be, because, I mean, it is a great love of yours, isn't it?
Yes, it is. I don't make a lot of money out of it, but I enjoy it.
I think that's absolutely marvellous. I mean, I know people like that.
There's the preschools.
Yeah. Sidney's totally irrepressible. Two companies on, he's still in toys, he still believes there's a rainbow at the end. For him.
That's going very well, we're doing it to major companies.
It would be jolly encouraging if one believed that this could replace Triang, but somehow I just can't see that happening.
Okay, from making the biggest toys in the country, I'm now making probably the smallest toys, but it's still the business, it still happens. And I'm enjoying it, and I think that's the main thing. It's
in a way depressing, Sidney, to hear you saying that you really cap out your ambition in this area. And you're really saying you don't want the aggro of a large staff, you don't want the aggro of a business which is beholden to the banks, and I can understand that, because most people would prefer not to be in that position. So this limits you to perhaps a doubling, maybe... multiplying by three, what you've got now.
Yeah.
And that you can more or less do with the way you're doing it at the moment.
Sir John, what is wrong with that? If it's profitable and...
I'm not knocking it.
And I can sleep at night and be happy.
Yeah. No, I'm not knocking it. But in terms of reviving the British toy industry, that ain't going to get us...
I won't be that person. No, I won't be that person.
Sidney may have limited ambitions, but it does take a man like him to buy a company like this from the receiver and bring it up again. And he is providing work for a plastics factory in Scotland, while he gets on and does the thing which he's good at, which is selling.
The yaw set's very nice. I hope you're going to place an order.
Well, I always say the same thing. I don't think your pattern's changed in the last 30 years since you dealt with a father.
But the sad truth is that every time we replace a large company by a small one, we've notched down a bit further. For the country's sake, we badly need smaller companies that are going to grow and really fight their way into the world markets. If that doesn't happen, we're just watching further erosion of our manufacturing base, and that's bad news for everybody.
But they have to come apart for cleaning purposes. You realise that, don't you?
Birmingham now, the former heartland of Britain's industrial might. And some of it is pretty depressing. We're all aware of the doom and gloom over the last couple of years, but there have been success stories in the middle of all this. And this town was the hometown of Apricot Computers. At the Apricot factory, I found good products, but they hadn't got the world scale and the world reach, and so they couldn't get the price that they needed to be successful. But the firm also had good and profitable software and maintenance divisions. And the problem was to persuade Roger Foster, who was the founder and chairman of the business and loved his manufacturing, to get out of that and concentrate on the good bits, the software and maintenance, which really could make money.
Don't you find it depressing, Sir John, that what you're really proposing is that this country loses the only microcomputer manufacturer it's got in probably the highest growth industry in the world, information technology,
yes.
And that you're actually proposing that we should cease to do that and buy them in boxes from the East or from America?
I dislike it intensely, but because I'm, you know, I'm a manufacturer and like you, I wear Union Jack underpants, Roger. But the fact of the matter is I'm more interested in Apricot surviving as a company. And if you don't actually get the profitability up, I don't believe you will survive as a company.
You can't tell Boeing to stop making aircraft without sort of making them their hackles get up a bit. We believe that within our niche we can actually make superior products and outsell the world.
Despite his apparent reluctance, Roger did the best thing for his company, now called ACT. He sold the whole of the manufacturing side, which was really his baby, to Mitsubishi in Japan. And he concentrated on the service and the software business. And what a fantastic success. Profits up 34% last year, one of the toughest years for computers and software and associated businesses there's been. He's expanding, he's buying in other businesses. That really is going gangbusters. But also, the factory's doing well as well. With their worldwide reach and sourcing, Mitsubishi were able to invest heavily in the factory and increase production. While I bemoan the fact that we couldn't do that as a British firm, it must be better to have a growing Japanese-owned factory than to have none at all.
Great. I feel quite choked and sentimental about this whole thing.
I'm off to see the Peake family now, who've been trying to make a go of their businesses based on their Suffolk apple farms at a time when farming too is having a jolly rough time.
Ah, there they all are.
Tomorrow, how marvellous to see you. How are you, love?
Mmm.
Hello.
Lovely to see you. Hello.
Hello, Tamara. You're the one I've been worrying about, actually. Now, who are you?
This is Donna, the friend of the family.
Now, where did you come from?
Ah, oh, we.
He's Scottish.
Yeah. Yeah. I'm hers.
Well, he's, how would we call it? It's sort of the greatest of
your
friends.
Toy boy.
How long have you given up work? When I first visited the Peake family, in addition to the farms themselves and the golf courses, they developed the largest fresh-pressed apple juice business in the country. Like a lot of other businesses in the 80s, they'd overborrowed and expanded too far, and the business was getting away from them. And I had to try and persuade them to sell before it was too late. But the Peakes loved their apple juice business, and it was a real wrench for them to face up to it.
I'm sure we could be absolutely we'd turn the page immediately.
I don't think that's right, if I may say so, Laura. You're going to be the whole time trying to swim against the tide.
I think until we've all decided what we want to do, if we decide to go the route of selling part or all of Capella, I think, to me, the most important thing is to look at the strengths and weaknesses of each of us.
That's right.
How we feel, which parts we would like to...
But the Peake family took the hard choice. They sold their beloved Capella apple juice business to Taunton Cider. I felt pretty happy then because they ended up with money in the bank, still had the golf courses and still had the farms, and I thought they were set fair, but the Peakes are compulsive business people. So they reinvested in a new business, and I cannot wait to see what they've done now.
I must say, honestly, this is immense. I mean, I can see why you two bargain hunters wanted to snap it up, but it really shakes me. And this is Capella to the power of 10.
About 10 acres.
The Peake family had their apples packed here. So I suppose it was inevitable that when it went bust and came up for sale through the receiver, Devorah Peake rushed in to buy it, complete with a management. It's a pretty big business, and it's got with it warehousing and cool storage, both of which can be let out. But the apple packing business itself is just the sort of business I hate. It's labour intensive, it's highly seasonal. Even when things go well, you don't make very much money. When things go badly, you can lose money like it's going out of fashion.
We've got three things here.
Yes.
We have the dry goods store, yes. We have the cold stores, and we have the pack house.
Yes.
Now, you're telling us now that the pack house can't pay.
No, I'm not. I'm not. I need to think about it. But I'm giving you my initial reactions, which are ones of stark horror. To pack your apples, you've got to pack twice as many apples for other people.
Which is not difficult. I'm sure we can get there.
I'm not saying it's difficult. What I'm trying to find out is whether it's profitable. You know, you've got to look at what you earn when everything goes well and what you lose if everything goes badly.
Yes, but that's why we've diversified. So what we're trying to say is that, obviously, apart from the weather aspects, which you can never control... We are trying in a way to control the rest of it.
I know you are. You're not doing stupid things, and I'm, you know, a man who's parachuted in and spent a fascinating afternoon with you. Look at what you're doing. But I suspect you bought it, as I said earlier, because it made her heart beat stronger, because it was the packing line to beat all packing line, and it is a super packing line.
Well, you see, it depends on your outlook.
I think you still want to be a fruit farmer.
That's right. That is my life.
I hadn't really expected to have to sit down and try and sort out another problem, and there's a certain familiarity about this situation. The family have invited me to a party in a couple of weeks' time, so that gives me a bit of time to do a bit more thinking and a few sums. Of all the firms I visited last time, the ones I had the greatest difficulty of getting my views through to were, without question, the Morgan family. I really got some idea of the size of the opportunity when I met John Worrell, one of the dealers, and heard about his waiting list.
At the moment, we're delivering cars to people who ordered them in 1978. That's 11 years ago, but 460 orders on our books. And last year we got 12 cars.
Well, on the basis of 12 cars and 450 people, it's a 40-year waiting list.
On paper, it's 40 years.
I'm definitely too late.
The Morgan family had asked me in to give some advice on how to increase production. And I thought it'd be quite easy to double production without spoiling the product in any way. I also thought it'd be pretty easy for them to be more efficient, to increase the prices and to be more profitable. But Peter and Charles Morgan had lower ambitions for the business, and my advice was pretty unpopular.
It's so often once had this situation where literally we've got all these orders, but they're not good. They're not good.
You would like to think that all your customers are magnificent people. But when one of them then sells his order on for £1,000, £2,000, which you see none of, you begin to wonder, well, was he a very nice customer for a Morgan, or was he just a speculator in Morgan car prices?
Well,
and if so,
but you might also,
do we want those sort of people? You know, not really. Not
oh,
really.
Come off it. You might also begin to wonder why you don't put your price up. People talk to me about the Morgan Car Company more than almost any other business I visited, and the arguments about which way the business should be going. So perhaps it's not surprising that Peter and Charles don't want to repeat performance, because, as I understand it, they've not changed their views, and I certainly haven't changed mine. It'd be interesting to meet John Worrell, the dealer, again, to find out what, if anything, has changed.
A bit different from last time. You were wearing a funny hat in a field.
Yes, well, now I'm at my humble Morgan garage, you see.
There's nobody who owns a Morgan who's humble.
increased production?
Oh, yes, they've certainly increased production, and it's a good 10% up, I think.
So they're producing, what, 10 cars now?
They're doing 10 cars a week, yes, which is 470, 480 cars a year, you said, every week.
Well, that's not to be sneered at. I mean, that is a 10% improvement. So what's your waiting list now?
It's probably about 8 or 9 years, in truth, although some agents will, of course, have waiting lists which are a lot lower, and probably as low as 4 or 5.
That's still quite surprising. Now, you'll be pleased to hear that I may be getting older. Morgans may be difficult to get, but I've got a Morgan.
You never have.
Yes,
you didn't
I
tell
have.
Me you were on
no,
the list.
No, no. Well, I wasn't on the list, but I got one on my waiting list.
Yes. Well, that's a real Mickey Mouse Morgan, isn't it?
Well, you're not, no, I'm not going to be drawn by that The Morgans always believed that their long waiting list would make them relatively recession-proof, and I'm glad it has. And I'm also glad that they managed to push the prices and increase production a bit. But I look on the whole episode as a major failure on my part, because I haven't been able to persuade them to seize what I see as a golden business opportunity, which would have been so much better for them and for everybody involved in the business. It's not just the private sector that's been having a rough time during the past 3 years. The public sector has been facing very painful changes as well, and none more so than the NHS.
This is a standard on many of the wards on this side of the road.
And that great hole in there.
When I went to Shropshire 3 years ago, they were in worse fettle than most. They had amongst the longest waiting lists and the biggest overspend in the country, and the whole thing was accompanied by a general feeling of doom and despair.
No, I'm right. Jim, I'm thinking of the investigation.
Ken Morris, the district general manager, was struggling with the political problems of trying to balance the books by shutting an ever-changing selection of hospitals. The strategy was confused and the whole county seemed to be in uproar.
I mean, the morale of the staff is so low, it's unbelievable. They just keep moving the goalposts and no one knows what's happening from one day to the next.
I think if the authority made it stunned and said, this is what's going to happen and do it, then we'd have to accept it.
You know damn well that the job of a manager is to manage with what he's got to achieve the best objectives for his customers within the constraints he finds himself in. Of course, to work on the constraints. Now, as far as you're concerned, as the manager, so in a year's time, you'll be working the waiting list down and you'll be operating within your budget.
There is a good chance of that. There's a good chance of that.
I mean, well, if we don't say, despite your great confidence that you're going to achieve this, and despite my cynicism and my bottle of champagne standing ready to be delivered, you don't succeed in achieving this. What do you think will happen?
I think we'll be back to the sort of package that I put forward to the members of the Health Authority, which was continuing the strategy that we
I said. Believe, I must say, you'll be in a lot more trouble than that. I think you just about run out of credibility with the regional authority. I would be quite surprised, Ken, if I was talking to you in another couple of years, unless you start to deliver.
Shortly after my visit, Ken Morris left. Meanwhile, the government has introduced big changes in the way in which the NHS is organised and managed. Ken himself is now running a small private healthcare company. I want to see him again because I've got some unfinished business with him.
Jolly nice of you to meet me.
My God.
There's a little bit more of you than there was. And how's life treating you?
Very well.
Are you rich?
Not yet. You know, we're
are
trying.
Are you going to be rich?
Oh, well, I think we'll get by, put it that way.
I'm not sure that's necessarily a part of it.
No, not at all. No, it's the main thing is to be happy, I think.
You remember, you and I really fell out on two things, the waiting list.
Yes, yes.
And the other thing that we fell out on really was the cottage hospital.
Yes.
Because I was very concerned at shutting the cottage hospitals and I wanted to go for a mixed economy solution.
The waiting lists started to go down as I was leaving, as I indicated that they might.
I can link Gordon a bit.
And indeed, so is the overspending, yes. All of the things that I put in train have started to materialise, put it that way.
Now, you remember, last time I saw you, I bet you three bottles of champagne or three bottles of baby sham if you pulled it off.
Yes.
Well, you'll be pleased to hear that...
I'm not owing you them, am I?
No. I've got
a bottle and a half of baby sham.
What a man.
Which...
Because I wasn't quite sure whether you'd want a bottle and a half of baby sham or a bottle and a half of the real stuff.
I actually have bought you.
Good grief.
The other half.
What a man. That's incredible, John.
But you don't get the three, mate. No way do you get the bloody three.
Go on.
Incidentally, wouldn't you agree it's a bloody sight nicer running a $4 million business at a profit than running a $120 million business when you can't make the books balance?
Absolutely. Oh, yes. Yes.
Because, I mean, you had a hell of a time, didn't you, trying to get the books to balance?
It was interesting. It was interesting.
There have been such enormous changes, really, in the way that the job that you were doing,
yes,
which I must say I did describe at the time as being nearly impossible to do. Yes. And you proved it was. Shropshire have balanced the budget and the waiting lists are down, but I'd like to go and see the doctors again, who were pretty cynical last time, to find out what life looks like from their point of view.
Making the decisions, as Bob said, actually putting them into action at the unit level is better and easier access to the manager and so on, and I think we function
that.
Better.
Certainly the strategies are clearer, yeah, but they are clear at all levels. They're clear at government level, regional level, district level, and therefore by the time it gets down to us, the strategy is quite clear. Yeah. Our involvement then is local.
Yeah.
Oh yes, I think so.
One of the problems, of course, is that while we may be involved, all the involvement and decision-taking is how to make more cuts. Because of the financial stricture. How are we going to reduce this level of service or do something within the economic constraints that we have?
But across the piece, do you reckon it was helpful for me to have visited last time or not?
Yes. Mm. We don't know what it would have been like if you hadn't visited.
Even worse.
Yeah, there are one or two. I mean, this is
the
kitchen.
Oh, yes, I remember that. Yeah. When I was here 3 years ago, I thought they needed simpler, clearer strategies which would command more support. There's no doubt the government changes and ideas have helped. But there's also no doubt in my mind that even though they can do with more money, and they always will need more money, the place is better managed and there's a great deal more clarity and general happiness around the place. I'm absolutely delighted that at least two of the cottage hospitals escaped the axe and through a mixed economy solution, which is what I wanted. Although I'm sorry that so many fell by the wayside, I still feel that we can't do without them, and they're going to have to find ways of opening some of the ones which were so hastily shut.
Where's the ward gone?
Well, the ward's been changed into separate rooms.
Hello, Jill.
Manager, sister.
Joe, I think it's the best, isn't it?
Super to see you here.
By diversifying, if you like, by being entrepreneurial, we've actually managed to save the place, where other cottage hospitals who didn't go down this route have actually closed and are now trying to reopen.
And I think, fortunately, when any of the GPs have rung for bed, it's very rarely I've had to say sorry. We haven't got one for them, so it's working out.
I mean, it's jolly
well,
obvious
it?
That it's needed, isn't it? It produces an absolutely vital service.
Yes, very much so.
I think it's absolutely fantastic, and well done, you too. Because, honestly, I was so depressed, I didn't give you
A cat in hell's price of
Five chances of survival. Now, what's this party going on?
Hello.
I think
that's we ought to join in.
Of course.
You're not expecting me to do it, are you?
Well, I think it's pretty poor if you don't.
Well, I get my exercise swimming.
Swing it high. I'm a much two hands if you can. Working on your waist.
Oh, that's a bit I need.
And how old are you now, if I may ask? Very rude to ask a lady's age.
Oh, I'm very proud of it. I am 106 and a half.
You're not.
If I live to December the 16th, I will be 107.
Isn't that great?
Thank you so much, sir.
Are you having a party?
Now, what do you think? Need you ask?
Exactly.
Last of all, I want to go back to Stoke-on-Trent to see how the pottery company, which I had such great hopes, is getting on.
The pottery industry is going through an extremely difficult period. Market conditions in the UK have been poor over the last 2 or 3 years. Many of our export markets, which has been our strength, are going into recession. But the prizes are there for the efficient people. I think Sir John was a catalyst when he came down last time. He encouraged us to address a lot of problems that we knew existed but had felt unable or unwilling to tackle, and we've benefited greatly as a consequence. Over the last 3 years, we've increased our profits fourfold. We've increased our turnover by 50 or 60%. Our product range has changed substantially. It's almost difficult to recognise from the product range that was there when Sir John came last time.
We're making here a mug.
Yeah.
Again, using a plaster mould.
When I visited Churchill 3 years ago, they were making pottery for the bottom end of the market. The three Roper brothers had built up the business to the stage where they were making more bowls and plates than anybody else in the country. What they weren't making was much money.
Give me some idea of what you're spending on design.
Well, for an average price, we could get a 10-inch plate design for £150, and that's to buy it outright.
Well, I think that's absolutely monstrous. I mean, I find it absolutely unbelievable that you can buy a design for a plate for £150.
Buying plates or design for mugs, I don't think we spend more than £5,000 or £6,000 a year.
Definitely not. No.
Well, it'd be difficult not to go up market from there, wouldn't it?
I mean, honestly, there are lots of adults.
The Ropers were just about to introduce their first middle market design called Mille Fleur.
It's quite a radical departure from what we've done before. Yeah.
They'd also got hold of some pretty good middle managers, like Bernard Burns in marketing, who seemed to me to have plenty of ideas, but lacked the headroom to apply them. The managers on the shop floor, too, had a lot of ideas for automation, which I liked, but again hadn't got the freedom to get them in.
Because, I mean, our labour, it will always be more expensive.
So I needed to persuade the Roper brothers to get their act together and to delegate more, which is never easy.
I'd like to see the three of you charge Bernard and Eddie and David to produce for you a plan which is going to improve the profit of the tableware division by £1 million next year. That plan has got to involve designs, machinery, capital expenditure, improvements in productivity, reductions in manning, the lot.
You've got to guide them.
That's your choice. You can give them as much room or as little room as you want. But the three of us are telling you, this is what we want out of the hotelware business. This is what we've got to get out of the tableware business. This is where the mugs have got to be. And you're driving the broad strategy, but you're not actually running the business. Now, they might surprise you. But the art, honestly, is to keep pressing them until they tell you that you're wrong.
3 years on, Bernard Burns has been made managing director of the tableware business.
Hello, Stephen. How super to see you.
While Stephen Roper is group chief executive.
You again, Sir John, and welcome back to Churchill.
Jolly nice to be here. And I'm glad to see you've got a factory still.
Yes, fortunately.
I visited Trying a couple of days ago. There isn't any factory there, just absolutely flattened ground. And you keep on buying them, don't you?
Well, we bought another one in May last year, about 3 miles away, to give us some increased production, new shapes, new decorations.
Not too many people are actually running out of capacity at the present moment.
No, Bernard, none of this running. You've got to have some respect for age.
Peter?
Hello there,
Matt. Nice to see you.
Nice to see you.
Hi, Candy.
Hi.
Well, there are a few more of you. You've been breeding like rabbits. Come on now. So how much are you spending now? I don't imagine all your lovelies are working for nothing.
Up till May, it was £21,000 up till May.
That's purely on bought-in design, with the whole design budget now, with all the trials we have to do and costs and salaries, it's getting on for £250,000. Yeah.
Oh, that's great. No, that's more like it.
Yeah,
so which of these have been the sellers?
Well, really, Paloma and Blackberry Trellis are the two that stand out the most.
Now, that's absolutely smashing.
Unsuccessful now is much, much more successful than unsuccessful used to be.
Yes. I
mean, a dog now actually makes money, whereas previously a dog was bad.
I'm absolutely thrilled to see the design team and the things they produced. It's just what this business needs. Now I'd like to see what Bernard as MD has actually achieved on the shop floor.
This is the new dust press. And what is it, German?
It's German.
Would be, wouldn't it? I mean, what's fascinating about this, Bernard, is you're light years away in some areas from where you were, but you're still light years away from where you want to be.
Yeah. Compared with when you were here last time, we've changed very important things, but easy things from a psychological point of view. Changing the design, although it was a major task at the time, was relatively easy. When it comes to production, it's almost a religion. I'd like to take all the processes from the biscuit kiln onwards and turn them into a continuous process. You got one process straight onto this, it spray glazes it straight into the kiln.
Does Stephen believe in that?
No. I'm afraid he doesn't. He sees me as a dangerous radical at the moment.
Well, he's giving you your head, though, isn't he?
Yes. Well, he's given me the right to argue with him, and that's what we're doing at the moment.
Well, come off it. He's giving you some money.
But it's very difficult for me, because I am perceived as being a non-potter, to have any credibility in
these
things.
Well, not only are you perceived to be a non-potter, you are a non-potter.
But I think a lot of it's common sense.
Production control and stock control must be an absolute nightmare.
Especially if you're doing it with quill pens.
Yeah. Are you still?
Yeah.
The changes in your company as viewed from outside are absolutely almost mind-boggling in 3 years. And yet the irony and the paradox is the more you change, the more you have to change. The more you change, the more you can change. Bernard certainly has got all sorts of ideas for revolutionising things in the factory, and indeed that you ultimately can get the factories to a position where it's a 24-hour-a-day factory, 7 days a week.
I shall be delighted if Bernard can prove that point. More than delighted.
So will I.
But I have to say, I think he's in danger at the moment of trying to change too many things, and he should concentrate on getting right the first sort of changes that he's put in place. And I shall look forward to you coming back in a few years' time. I think we shall be a lot more efficient in our warehousing and distribution, but I would be surprised if you will see a revolution on the shop floor.
Well, I mean, you can make it or break it, Stephen. That's up to you. But I believe a revolution on the shop floor is still possible.
No, it was good to see the old sailor himself again, wasn't it, Sir John? Because it's been 3 years, and there's been quite a lot of change, actually, hasn't there, at Churchill over this last 3 years?
I still disagree with him over this change at a rate of knots.
When Sir John came to see us, it actually failed to take into account where we'd come from in 25 years, from one little factory, all the way through to being a major force.
People would be that interested in that aspect of it, though.
But it didn't come across in the
program. They want to know where you're going.
We came across as being rather staid, and that we hadn't really been too far.
But
you weren't really going too far, which was really untrue.
Well, it's a bit of everything, isn't it, really? Thank you for...
Of all the companies I've visited, the Roper Brothers business is moving the fastest. They're more united, they've delegated responsibility, and with profits up considerably, they're even looking to float on the stock exchange. Having started my journey against the background of the recession and then with the horrible shock of seeing Triang, it really is encouraging to see success stories such as this. My life after retiring from ICI hasn't been at all the sort of pipe and slippers existence which my wife and I fondly imagined. But there have been real compensations because I've learnt so much from the companies I've been trying to help. In particular, I've been told over and over again that it's important to be happy and to enjoy business. And I'm sure that's right. But for the sake of every single one of us, we need more people who enjoy their business and have the ambition and determination to grow them to world competitive success. Now I'm looking forward to trying to help another series of companies with different sorts of problems and opportunities. But before that, I've got one bit of unfinished business.
I'm on my way to meet the Peake family again. I thought a bit about their apple packing business and I've got a pretty good idea what they ought to do about that. But they tell me they've got some developments and some news about Capella, the fruit juice business. And knowing their infinite capacity to scare the hell out of me, I just can't wait to find out what they've done now. You lot have given me a really bad week. I spent my time being absolutely terrified that... What you've done now, I can't imagine.
I'd be terrified too, I'm telling you.
Are you asking us a question?
Yes, this is a great moment when you tell me all.
Shall we take you out of your misery?
Please do. No, or you may be about to put me into it. I mean, don't be too sure.
Well, actually, I'm very glad to tell you that we, as a family and a company, have bought Capella back. Now, don't call us. It's all right, come on. No, it's all right, it's lovely.
You are without exception.
What? Careful.
You're impossible. There are a lot of you. Now, one of the happy things that I took away was that the family borrowings were under control.
It is under control.
But it's still under control.
It is.
So you've got it for nothing?
No.
Flippin' heck.
There's a few changes here since you came last time.
My God. Having seen this, I don't think buying back Capella is necessarily as disastrous as I feared. They've got a bargain and they've got a lot of nice new plant as well. The whole thing wouldn't be so bad if they hadn't gone and bought the apple packing business they showed me so proudly last time, and which I think perhaps they could turn into a co-op. I think you ought to act as a catalyst to set up, I don't know, East Anglian Packers Cooperative or something.
Yeah.
Get a number of other people to take a share of the operation. Any gains or losses come back to you as a part of the cooperative. But I think you ought to have about 25% of that and get it off your back. Let that be run as a completely separate operation. That reduces one area of risk. But I'd like to think, I need to think a good deal more about Capella now that Capella's back in the scene, and what's new. I don't know what I've been doing for the last 3 years.
We did take your advice when we sold out.
Yeah, that's the great thing about this family. You take my advice for about 20 minutes.
You're right. Right,
oh, what we need is a double Capella. I just walk in the
Next week at 9:50, Sir John tells the old Cinderella story when he visits a Wakefield shirt manufacturer.